The book is called The Communist, Frank Marshall Davis, The Untold Story of Barack Obama's Mentor, by a great professor, Professor Paul Kangor of Grove City College. How are you, sir?
Good, Mark. Great to be with you. Thanks.
It's my pleasure. So who was Frank Marshall Davis?
Well, it's really almost impossible to imagine that a president would have a mentor who was an actual, literal, no exaggeration, card-carrying member of Communist Party USA. But but that's Frank Marshall Davis.
So he was a member of the Communist Party USA.
He was. In fact, his number was 47544. I mean, we have a kind of hard evidence on him that we had of some of the Hollywood 10 that the Congress called to Washington to testify in the late 40s. And I'd say we have even more than that. In fact, he was the rare Obama biographer that will mention him, Mark, will frame Davis as this victim of rabid Republican right-wing McCarthyites. But in fact, he was pursued by Democrats. And he demonized Democrats like Harry Truman. And it was the Democrats who called him to Washington to testify in December 1956 for his Soviet activities. He pleaded the Fifth Amendment. Didn't matter. It was the Senate Judiciary Committee run by Democrats. The next year, in 1957, they produced a report called, get this, Scope of Soviet Activity Inside the United States, unquote. And there they listed him as an identified member of the Communist Party. The FBI had him under surveillance for probably 20 years. And in the book, I reprint pages from his FBI file. And most remarkable of all, and this is a really stunning, halting thought, the FBI listed Frank Marshall Davis, the current president's mentor, on the federal government security index. Which meant that in the event of a war breaking out between the United States and the Soviet Union, Frank Marshall Davis could be placed under immediate arrest.
Frank Marshall Davis. So was he a powerful member? Obviously. Why was he? How was he such a powerful member of the Communist Party?
Well, he was a very influential member. He joined the party in Chicago in the 1940s, and Chicago was an absolute hotbed of Communist Party USA, second only to New York, and in some respects even stronger than New York. The party was founded in Chicago in September 1919, and he joined the party there during World War II, I estimate 1943. It wasn't 43, it was like 44. He was so prominent that he became the founding editor-in-chief of the Chicago Communist Party newspaper, the Chicago Star, which the locals called the Red Star. And he edited that from 1946 to 48. He wrote a column for every edition. He shared the page with folks like Senator Claude Pepper, who was known as Red Pepper, and who at the time that he was writing for the Chicago Star actually wrote the bill to socialize medicine in the United States, which Frank Marshall Davis advocated. And at that page, there were even people like Lee Pressman, who was a KGB agent, worked with Alger Hiss, I.F. Stone, who we know worked for the Soviets from 1936 to 38, and other folks. In fact, the star writer for the paper was a man named Johanna Steele, reporter. And he was so close to the Kremlin that he actually got an exclusive interview with Stalin's foreign minister, Molotov, and they ran it in the Chicago Star. So Davis had a literal direct line to the Kremlin if he wanted it.
Well, did he have a direct, did he use it?
Well, that's a good question. And I can't say how close he actually got to Moscow, but the federal government was very suspicious. So suspicious that, you know, they had him under surveillance, FBI had him under surveillance, and when he suddenly, on a dime, inexplicably, got up and left Chicago in 1948 to go to Honolulu, it looks like that was probably a party-ordered move. The FBI file shows that his salary was paid by Harry Bridges' ILWU, which was an old communist-controlled union.
All right, we're gonna run out of time. I want to lock this down, one thing. How did Barack Obama come in contact with Frank Marshall Davis?
Well, when Obama was 9 years old, this would have been 1970, he was introduced to Davis by his grandfather, Stanley Dunham. And Stanley Dunham, just to give you an idea of how far to the left his politics were, I mean, he picked Davis, knowing who he was, knowing his background, as a black male role model, father figure, mentor for his grandson, because Obama was lacking all of that, because Obama's father was out of the picture. He was gone.
So Obama's grandfather was a big leftist then?
Clearly he must have been, had to have been, because everybody in Hawaii knew who Frank Marshall Davis was. I mean, he was famous. He was infamous. I mean, he was the guy that, you know, literally called out of Honolulu to be flown to Washington for a dramatic showdown in December 1956 with the Senate Judiciary Committee. And Obama's grandfather drank with him, played Scrabble with him. And according to one person's account, the person who was there when they were first introduced, Obama's grandfather even smoked dope with Frank Marshall Davis. If you could picture that, two men in their 60s smoking pot together.
But you know what, Professor? This could explain why his daughter or Obama's mother was such a leftist too.
Right.
Now let me ask you this though: what do we know about the influence Frank Marshall Davis about communism? He wasn't just a card-carrying communist; he was a card-making communist. What kind of effect did he have on Obama? How did they interact?
Well, it's a good question. He's mentioned a lot in Dreams from My Father. In fact, 22 times by the name Frank, dozens more via pronouns, other forms of reference. And it's hard for me to say, Mark, you know, where exactly Davis, you know, Davis said A and Obama said B, and thus, you know, Obama said that because he learned it from Davis. But you go back and you read his columns, and he's blasting big business, Wall Street, banks, big oil, excess profits, corporate executives and their fat contracts, millionaires, the wealthy, GOP tax cuts that spare the rich. You know, the millionaires who don't pay their fair share.
Wait a minute. Whose columns are these, Davis or Obama? Yeah, I get confused.
He's calling for wealth redistribution to fund universal health care and public works projects to keep us from a Great Depression. That's all Davis. And you read that in these old Chicago Communist Party publications, and you think, this is very similar to the current president.
Yeah, that's official Obama administration policy.
Right, it is. And here's a trivia question for your listeners. Name one American who doesn't like Winston Churchill. Well, 4 years ago, we couldn't name one until Barack Obama came into the office and sent the bust of Churchill back to the British. Well, here's another one. Frank Marshall Davis, who utterly excoriated Winston Churchill in his columns for the Chicago Star and the Honolulu Record. That's
so,
quite a coincidence.
So, I mean, when you hear Obama say things like he said 10 days ago, 2 weeks ago, in Roanoke, Virginia, attacking the individual, successful people, I mean, not even big business, just attacking what really is the heart and soul of the country, small business, individuals who innovate and so forth. You probably said, yeah, that's par for the course, right?
Yeah, I did. And when I see things like Obama's actions with General Motors, Frank Marshall Davis's biggest demons in his columns were Winston Churchill, Harry Truman, and General Motors. And he was constantly blasting General Motors for its alleged obscene profits. If Frank Marshall Davis could have nationalized General Motors, he would. So I'm at the point now where anytime I hear Obama say something like that, I go back to my boxes and start flipping through the Chicago Star and Honolulu Record. And, oh boy, new slogan for Obama 2012, forward? Let me take a look. Oh, look, front page of the Chicago Star. Look at
that. Oh, really?
Bravely
was it?
Forward. Yeah.
Is what? Well, tell me about that word. Where was it?
The phrase forward, the new Obama slogan for 2012. It's literally on the cover of the Chicago Star, one of the editions from 1946.
And that's the communist paper.
Yeah, I mean, that's an old communist slogan. Socialists used it. And I also found in the kickoff edition of the Chicago Star, this would be July 6, 1946, Davis's very first column. It's called Those Radicals of 76. And Davis there talks about the need for fundamental change in America, fundamental change by strong radicals. So even slogans like that, Obama and change, which, by the way, were coined by people like David Axelrod. I don't know if you have time to get into all this, but Obama's mentor, Frank Marshall Davis, and this is hard to believe, but I assure you it's true, actually worked in Chicago in communist front groups with the Cantors, Harry and David Cantor, who mentored David Axelrod in the 70s, and it gets better. He also worked with Vernon Jarrett, who was Valerie Jarrett's father-in-law, and Robert Taylor, who was Valerie Jarrett's grandfather.
All right, now listen to me. I was only going to have you one segment. That's changed. I'm going to have you the next segment, the final segment of the program. I want to walk through this again.
Okay.
Because this is very, very important. We're not talking about garden variety Democrats here like Harry Truman or John Kennedy. We're talking about something that's very, very different, aren't we, Professor?
These are the people that Truman and Jack Kennedy went after. Mm-hmm. I mean, these were the people that the old anti-communist Cold War Democrats said, you know, these are bad guys. And the fact that Democrats today would defend people like Frank Marshall Davis, that's got Davis laughing from his tomb. Because guys like Davis went after Harry Truman and Jack Kennedy.
Well, listen, when we come back, I want to get a little bit into Axelrod and Jarrett and the rest of them, because it's all making sense. It made sense before, but now it even makes more sense. I'm talking to Professor Paul Kengor of the Grove City College. He's got this outstanding book out. It's called The Communist, Frank Marshall Davis, The Untold Story of Barack Obama's Mentor. Ladies and gentlemen, this is one damn compelling book. I'll be right back.
Mark Levin.
This is some book, folks. It's called The Communist, Frank Marshall Davis, The Untold Story of Barack Obama's Mentor, by Professor Paul Kengor of the Grove City College. And you've written a number of great books. As a matter of fact, a couple of weeks ago, I talked at length about David Axelrod, based mostly on your research, Professor. So tell us more about Axelrod and Jarrett and so forth.
Sure. Okay, well, I'll start with Jarrett. And Jarrett's grandfather was named Robert R. Taylor. And I know all of this is going to sound unbelievable to people, but I assure you it's true. I mean, I carefully documented it. But I have right here, I could pick it up and drop it on the desk, and you could hear it thud. It's 2,100 pages. It's a congressional report from 1944. It was run by Democrats, called Investigation of Un-American Propaganda Activities in the United States. And both Robert R. Taylor, Valerie Jarrett's grandfather, and Frank Marshall Davis, Obama's mentor, are listed here together and participating in one of the worst communist front groups in the history of the United States, the American Peace Mobilization, which was horrible because this group accommodated Hitler because Hitler signed a pact with Stalin in 1939. So that's a very short way of putting that Frank Marshall Davis worked with Robert Taylor, Valerie Jarrett's grandfather. Now, he also worked with Valerie Jarrett's father-in-law, Vernon Jarrett, and Frank Marshall Davis worked with him on the Packing House Workers Union, which was a communist-controlled union in Chicago. Now, also working with that union and also writing for Frank Marshall Davis's Chicago Star and doing a bunch of other things were the Cantors, Harry and David Cantor. Now, if everybody's taking notes on this, Harry Cantor was secretary of the Boston Communist Party. In 1930, he ran for governor of Massachusetts on the Communist Party ticket. He was so bad that in 1932, he moved the entire family to the Soviet Union, where he was officially employed by the Soviet government, Stalin's government, to translate Lenin's writings for the Bolsheviks. Now, Harry and David Cantor would go on and mentor David Axelrod in the 1970s. So basically...
Now, wait a minute. The Cantors would mentor Axelrod how?
Well, they met him in Chicago. Axelrod's not originally from Chicago. He's from New York. He had a number of offers to go to different colleges. He went to the University of Chicago. He started working for a newspaper called the Hyde Park Herald, and it was their very left-leaning paper. And it was there that he met the Cantors and came under their wing. And they helped to get him involved in politics and even involved in the Harold Washington mayoral campaign in Chicago in the 1980s.
So these folks have so much in common philosophically. They have various ties. And no wonder they trust each other. No wonder this is such a closed circle. Right, Professor?
Yeah. Oh, it's all in the political family. I mean, we're in a sense being governed today by the ghosts of Chicago's old Communist Party circles from the 1940s. And to be clear, it doesn't mean that Valerie Jarrett and David Axelrod and Obama are communists, or that they're, you know, closet card-carrying members of Communist Party USA. But you had these really radical far-left influences on these, you know, very much hard-left people.
Well, I'm running out of time. Does this explain why the Obama sat in Reverend Wright's church? Does this explain why Obama had a very friendly and a political relationship with Ayers and Dorn? Does this explain his relationship with Khalidi, the mouthpiece for the PLO and so forth? These were his circles, right?
Yes, and I'm convinced that even more precisely that Frank Marshall Davis is the missing link, the connecting link from Obama's years in Hawaii to these later radical influences like Bill Ayers, Jeremiah Wright, and the others.
Meaning you're convinced that he helped introduce them?
No, not that he helped introduce them, but if you follow Obama's political, ideological, intellectual development, going from a, you know, very left-leaning mother. I mean, gee, Obama's mom and dad met in a Russian language class at the University of Hawaii in the fall of 1960. Grandfather was a leftist. And then through the 70s, so that's in the 60s. And then Davis is there through the 70s. And then in the 80s, Obama goes off to Occidental and Columbia and Jeremiah Wright and
Bill. Well, listen, we're out of time. Professor, I have to have you back. This is compelling. Ladies and gentlemen, the book is The Communist, Frank Marshall Davis, The Untold Story of Obama's Mentor by Professor Paul Kengor. You can get it on Amazon.com, any bookstore, my social sites. I strongly urge it. Professor, good work. This book needs to be broadly considered. See you tomorrow, America.